Rejoice in the Lord, all you people. Give thanks to God.
In the midst of the congregation,
be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, the fountain of all wisdom, you know our necessities before we ask and our ignorance in asking. Have compassion on our weakness and mercifully give us those things which for our unworthiness we dare not and for our blindness we cannot ask. Through the worthiness of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Amos. This is what the Lord God showed me, a basket of summer fruit. He said, Amos, what do you see? And I said, a basket of summer fruit. Then the Lord said to me, the end has come upon my people Israel. I will never again pass them by. The songs of the temple shall become wailings in that day, says the Lord God. The dead bodies shall be many, cast out in every place. Be silent. Hear this, you that trample on the needy, and bring to ruin the poor of the land, saying, when will the new moon be over so that we may sell grain? And the Sabbath so that we may offer wheat for sale? We will make the ephah small and the shekel great and practice deceit with false balances, buying the poor for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals, and selling the sweepings of the wheat. The Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob, surely I will never forget any of their deeds. Shall not the land tremble on this account, and everyone mourn who lives in it, and all of it rise like the Nile and be tossed about and sink again like the Nile of Egypt? On that day, says the Lord God, I will make the sun go down at noon and darken the earth in broad daylight. I will turn your feasts into mourning and all your songs into lamentation. I will bring sackcloth on all loins and baldness on every head. I will make it like the mourning for an only son, and the end of it like a bitter day. The time is surely coming, says the Lord God, when I will send a famine on the land, not a famine of bread or a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. They shall wander from sea to sea and from north to east. They shall run to and fro, seeking the word of the Lord, but they shall not find it. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Colossians. Jesus is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him all things, in heaven and on earth, were created, things visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or powers. All things have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the holy body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. And through him God was pleased to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross. And you, who were once estranged, and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he has now reconciled in his fleshly body. Through death, so as to present you holy and blameless and irreproachable before him, provided that you continue securely established and steadfast in the faith, without shifting from the hope promised by the gospel that you heard, which has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven. I, Paul, became a servant of this gospel. I am now rejoicing in my sufferings for your sake. And in my flesh, I am completing what is lacking in Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, that is, the church. I became its servant according to God's commission that was given to me for you, to make the word of God fully known, the mystery that has been hidden throughout the ages and generations, but has now been revealed to his saints. To them, God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of his glory, of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. It is he whom we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone in all wisdom, so that we may present everyone mature in Christ. The word of the Lord.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
As Jesus and his disciples went on their way, Jesus entered a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. She had a sister named Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks. So she came to him and asked, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her then to help me." But the Lord answered her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her. The Gospel of the Lord.
Please pray with me. Gracious God, help us always to seek the truth, come whence it may, cost what it will. Amen. In the words of the prophet Amos, the end is come. For the people of Israel, the songs of the temple shall become wailings. The dead bodies will be many, cast out from every place. If those words aren't challenging enough, Amos goes on to say that there will be a famine in the land. Not a famine of bread or water, but a famine on hearing the words of the Lord. Amos is saying that the people of Israel will be utterly cut off from God. Hard words, tough words, plain spoken words. No one would characterize Amos as being known for nuance. He had a tough message to deliver, unlike the angels who get to say things like, "Behold, I bring you tidings of great joy." The prophets often were called to speak truth to power. Frederick Buechner has described prophets as spokespersons for God, not fortune tellers, that it was their vocation to do nothing less than to have the audacity to stand up and speak on behalf of the Lord God, creator of the universe. Buechner also quips that there is no evidence to suggest that any prophet invited home for supper was ever invited twice. Hard words. And I think that we have a human tendency to read a passage like that or hear it and render it a rant and then move on looking for more comfortable words. And Reinhold Niebuhr, amongst others, have said that a preacher's job is to comfort the afflicted and to afflict the comfortable. Well, it's sort of an affliction kind of day, but never, ever without hope. What I'd like to explore with you this morning is, what was Amos trying to say? What was he trying to say to the people in his time? What's he saying to us today? Now, the book of Amos is an anthology of oracles, and contained within it is Amos's critique of the practices of the powerful in the north and their oppression of the poor and the needy and those on the margins. We heard in the scripture this morning that he talks about some of the socioeconomic injustices, false weights and measures. The whole book characterizes the avarice and exploitation of those least set up to defend themselves, those on the margins. And he calls the people to account, to repent. Amos was one of the first prophets to be lifted up as putting a bright light of national conscience on a nation. And I think that it doesn't take much imagination for any of us to put a bright light on some of the social injustices in our day, in our time. And the power and the poignancy of Amos's words beg the questions for us: what is our culpability and what is our capability? In what ways are we implicit in some of the social injustices in our time? And what's our capacity? What is our will to help change those things, to help bring about the kingdom of God in our time? We can look around the world and see questionable labor practices, questionable lending practices, Ponzi schemes, those who make scam phone calls to prey on the elderly. I can't imagine that any of that is pleasing in God's sight. Perhaps bringing it a little more closer to home, I, like anyone, enjoys a bargain. But how often do we step back and think about the labor practices that were employed for the manufacture of the clothes we wear, or the harvesting of the food that we eat? And lest we think that these are just Old Testament Hebrew scripture rantings and ravings, remember what Jesus said about the poor and the needy. Jesus spoke 5 times more about economic and money issues than he did about prayer. Harkening back to Deuteronomy, and particularly the 15th chapter, where we are commanded to do something about the poor and the needy. The 11th verse talks about there will always be poor among us, and we are commanded, not asked, commanded to offer open hands to the poor and the needy in our midst. Well, how do we know what is ours to do? How do we know what we are called to do? How do we know that we are living in God's will? I think one of the most alive and powerful ways that God continues to speak to us is through Holy Scripture. That was one of the most damning things that Amos said in that prophecy, was that the people would no longer hear the word of the Lord. Holy Scripture, the Bible, is a living word intended for us to wrestle with the hard things, to learn and to grow and to deepen our faith, our understanding, our purpose, our call. In speaking about the Bible, theologian Brian Blount says that nothing that is living is everlast, that a living word is always a beginning word. Beginning in September, this cathedral community is going to invite all of you to join together in a rigorous Bible study. Some of you may be familiar with it. It's been around for 25 years. It's Disciple Bible Study. And it's designed not just to inform, but to transform, to help us be better disciples, followers of Christ in life, in mission. And many of you have told me that, you know, I've always wanted to read the Bible cover to cover, but I've never managed to quite get that done. Well, you have an opportunity. One of the courses of Disciples Bible Study is designed to, in the fall, take you through Hebrew Scriptures, and in the spring, go through the New Testament in small groups, groups of about 12, having an introductory videotape of a biblical scholar lending expertise on the passage with which you are about to wrestle, study manuals, and then together as community to listen for what God is saying to you, to us, to all of us as community. For those of you who can't commit a year for various reasons, there are other courses that are going to be offered, 6 to 8 week courses, where you can delve more deeply into some of the books of the Bible, the formative books of the Bible, like Genesis, Psalms, Romans. Have you ever asked the question, what's God's purpose in my life? Who is God calling me to be? How do I know if I'm living into the will of God, using the gifts God has given me? Lift up the word. Listen for the living word of God in your life. If you would like to explore some of those questions, there's information about Disciple Bible Study at the congregation table. Look for the purple banners in the back. Knowing that some of you are visiting and some of you follow us online, look for Bible studies in your own places of worship and communities. What I can tell you is that your life will change. Be prepared to be transformed. The living word will do that. Some of you may have seen recently the story about the couple from Union, Iowa, population 394, who recently received an award at the White House. They were the 5,000th point of light. They had traveled to Tanzania on a mission trip. They were there to help rebuild an HIV/AIDS hospital. And in the process, the living word of the Lord caused their heart to tear. And it didn't just cause them to experience the starvation and the need and the poor in Tanzania. It sent them home with a challenge to make a difference. They started a nonprofit called Outreach Inc. And in the years since its inception, they have sent over 233 million meals to starving children in 15 countries, including the United States. Food, safe water, medicine, education, helping to bring about the kingdom of God in our time. Be prayerful about entering this time of biblical study and reading and meditating and acting on the word of the Lord. What have you got to lose? Maybe a little bit of time, but in the process, you might just gain a fulfillment, a meaning in your life that is transformative. And I think along the way, maybe transforming lives of others. And I suspect that even Amos would join the angels and the heavenly hosts in rejoicing. Amen.
We rise and affirm our faith in the words of the ancient Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Ever-present God, your living word, in Jesus, your living word, you grace the home of Mary and Martha. You grace us still in word and at table. Direct our attention to the necessary in our lives and our prayers, to welcome in your name, to extend your grace, to receive others as we would receive you. God of grace and mercy, we pray for the church in every place, for Catherine, our presiding bishop, and Marianne, our bishop, and all the holy people of God. Keep us faithful in mission, that we may know joy. Keep us rooted in ministry, the work you have given us to do. God of grace and mercy, we pray for our country, for those who face with courage any great decision, for all who will engage in settling the affairs of people and of nations, for all who mold public opinion in our time, for all who write what others will read. God of grace and mercy, give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. God of grace and mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, spirit, or relationship. Grant them strength in suffering and power in weakness. Make us instruments of your healing grace, that we may minister to one another in your name. God of grace and mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those who are dying and all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled. God of grace and mercy,
gracious God, show us life's better part, for we live worried, hectic, distracted lives. In our busyness and neglect of you, we trample the needy and bring ruin to the poor. famished for your nourishing word, we resent those who pause to feast at your feet. In gentleness, guide us yet again into your presence, that we may love and serve you with singleness of heart. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Let us confess our sins to God. God of all mercy, we confess that we have sinned against you, opposing your will in our lives. We have denied your goodness in each other, in ourselves, and in the world you have created. We repent of the evil that exists in us, the evil we have done, and the evil done on your behalf. Forgive, restore, and strengthen us, our Savior Jesus Christ, that we may abide in your love and serve only your will. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of Christ be always with you.
Please be seated. Once again, it's a joy to welcome you to the Cathedral. We have at least two groups visiting with us today. From the great state of Tennessee, we have Nolensville United Methodist Youth. Where are you? Great, I see you back there. Wonderful, welcome. And would all of you join me in not just welcoming, but thanking our guest choir from Calvary Episcopal Church, Pittsburgh, for their wonderful music ministry among us this morning. What follows in the service is known by different names depending on your tradition: the Lord's Supper, the Holy Eucharist, the Mass. Anyone and everyone who's desirous of a deeper relationship with God is encouraged to come forward and receive communion. Just follow the instructions of the ushers. If you'd prefer to receive a blessing instead, just cross your arms over your chest and we'll know that that's your desire and intention. During the time of communion, we have healing ministers who will be waiting to pray with and for you for healing in mind, body, spirit, relationship. And they'll be in Memorial Chapel, which is just to the left and behind the platform here. As we reflect on the ways in which God showers blessings on us day by day and week by week, we have an opportunity out of thanksgiving and gratitude for all that we have received to give back, to help this cathedral continue its ministry to the poor and the needy and the hurting and the suffering in this city, in the nation, and in the world. And so we invite you to give as you are able. And now walk in love. As Christ loved us and gave himself for us an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and good and joyful to give you thanks, all holy God, source of life and fountain of mercy. You have filled us and all creation with your blessing and fed us with your constant love. You have redeemed us in Jesus Christ and knit us into one body. Through your Spirit, you replenish us and call us to fullness of life. Therefore, joining with angels and archangels and with all the faithful of every generation, we lift our voices with all creation as we sing. Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of the universe and giver of life. You formed us in your own image and called us to dwell in your infinite love. You gave the world into our care that we might be your faithful stewards and show forth your bountiful grace. But we failed to honor your image in one another and in ourselves. We would not see your goodness in the world around us, so we violated your creation, abused one another, and rejected your love. Yet you never ceased to care for us and prepared the way of salvation for all people. Through Abraham and Sarah, you called us into covenant with you. You delivered us from slavery, sustained us in the wilderness, and raised up prophets to renew your promise of salvation. Then, in the fullness of time, you sent your eternal word, made mortal flesh, in Jesus, born into the human family and dwelling among us, he revealed your glory. Giving himself freely to death on the cross, he triumphed over evil, opening the way of freedom and life. On the night before he died for us, our Savior Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." As supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Remembering his death and resurrection, we now present to you from your creation this bread and this wine. By your Holy Spirit, may they be for us the body and blood of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Grant that we who share these gifts may be filled with the Holy Spirit and live as Christ's body in the world. Bring us into the everlasting heritage of your daughters and sons, that with all your saints, past, present, and yet to come, we may praise your name forever. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever. Amen. As we join our prayers with those of the Church Universal, so we say each in our own language the prayer that Jesus Christ has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. People of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. pray together. Loving God, we give you thanks for restoring us image and nourishing us with spiritual food in the sacrament of Christ's body and blood. Now send us forth as a people forgiven, healed, renewed, that we may proclaim your love to the world and continue in the risen life of Christ our Savior. Amen. The wisdom of God, the love of God, and the grace of God strengthen you to be Christ's hands and heart in this world, in the name of the Holy Trinity. Amen.
In peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.